That's awesome. Well done. I just want to, you know, sometimes we say, oh, the team, but some of you don't know who the team is. Well, Chris Booth is our graphic and tech guy around here. So thank you, Chris. He led worship tonight and he did that video. And Dave Beattie, who plays the drums, and his worker built the stage. And a lot of people stood around to watch them. And as you do now, a few helped. Our interns helped, and that was awesome. And you know, it just shows me that you can't do anything without team, and you need people to help. And in this series, it's all about when the ark is about Noah, and when he built an ark, it was to save his family. And we recognize that as a church, we need one another, and it's all about helping one another, save one another. David did such an outstanding job this morning preaching the message, and at night, we don't necessarily do the same message, but we wanted to give a good introduction to this series. And I'm sitting on the front row, to be honest, today, and I'm going like, really, David? I mean, really? It was so good. I was like, really? I have to follow that? And it was like, he should be up here again. But it's always good to have a little different voice. Mine's a little higher than David's. And but this series is about us helping navigate this life in which we live. And tonight's series message is called The Complete Salvation. And I love how the fact is that your life and my life, we're on a journey of a complete salvation. You know, I was saved when I was 4, but I'm more saved today than I was when I was 4. Not my spiritual person, but my soul person. There's a big difference, is that instantly at 4, I was saved, and there was no changing, no turning back from that encounter I had with Jesus, and I was alive unto God, and I was totally mature in my spirit. Hello? Amen. Think about it. Think about Jesus Christ enters in, and he says he's going to take our life out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. And he's going to do a transformational work. Well, that's the work that you and I are in right now. It's a transformational, ongoing work. So I have a greater salvation today because I have sanctification in my life. I have a degree of God at work in my life, and it continues every day, just like your life continues every day into that complete finished work of Christ. Matthew 24, turn with me there. As it says, is the ark series activating the real kingdom. So we're going to talk about the real kingdom, activating the real kingdom. In Matthew 24, verse 37, 39, when the Son of Man returns, it will be like it was in Noah's day. In those days before the flood, the people were enjoying banquets and parties and weddings right up to the time Noah entered his boat. People didn't realize what was going to happen until the flood came and swept them all away. That is the way it will be when the Son of Man comes. Interesting. Are you concerned about the second coming of Christ? Anybody concerned about the second coming of Christ? Do you think about the second coming of Christ? You know, being a Christian all my life, I remember when I was a teenager and I'm going like, Jesus, I really love you. I really, really do, but I want to get married. Anybody else say that? Anybody else say that? You know, Jesus, Jesus, I really love you, but I want to have children, Andrew. And and it's like, Jesus, Jesus, I really love you, but I want to have grandchildren. You know what I'm saying? It's like there's something in our humanity that we really don't want to face the end times of Jesus. But yet in the Word of God, he desires us to want to have his Son to return. And yet in our humanistic mind frame that we live in, we get consumed with self. We get consumed with ourself. We get consumed with our own needs. We get consumed with our life and how we want to live our life. And so when we talk about the second coming of Christ, we kind of go, oh, I love you, Jesus. Please hold off a little longer. And then every day we cry out, oh, Jesus, save us. Oh, but don't come yet. Just save us now. Don't come. I just want, you know, we live in this like, And so in the time of Noah, it's interesting to me, we had a little discussion when the ark was being built back here and how long, 100 years took Noah to build the ark. 100 years. And say what? Well, he didn't have power. That is true. He didn't have power tools like we had here. We didn't have power tools. But at the same time, it was still a long process. It was a long journey. And we kind of had this little bit of a discussion. I think why it took Noah 100 years, one of the reasons was they didn't have power tools. He had to make probably every wooden, I want to say nail, that put it together. He grooved it all together. How did he do that? You know, it was specifically done. He didn't even know what he was building. He'd never seen a boat. There was never any water. Can you imagine it? You know, we just don't even have that concept. They didn't have rain. So when God says to Noah, I want you to build me this boat, and it's going to be huge. It's going to be an oil tanker size and then some. What is that? You know, it's like the children of Israel when manna appeared and they said, what is it? Well, it's going to sustain you. Amazing. 100 years. Noah spent 100 years. But I think why it took him some time, because 100 years he was trying to convince the people that God had spoken to him and that they needed to get on the boat. Can you imagine? God was trying to say, for 100 years, come on, there's safety in the boat. Get in the boat. Believe Noah. Come along. You can be part of the regeneration of my nation or my world and populating my earth. Did it really take Noah 100 years, or is that how long God was saying, okay, let's give it another week. Let's give it another bit. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Because in actuality, it probably didn't take him all that long to actually build the boat. But he preached every day to his neighbors, to his family, to those who came and said, hey, Noah, what are you doing? And I believe in the end times today, God is doing the same thing in our land, in our world, in our neighborhood, in our families. He's giving us an opportunity to preach. He's giving us an opportunity to speak forth the truth, the word of God. There's safety in my kingdom. There's safety in my kingdom. Will you come into my kingdom? And we've got some hard-headed people, don't you know? I'm sure you've got friends. I'm sure you have family. I'm sure you have people around you that just haven't gotten it yet. And you're bringing it home all the time. Come on, believe, you know. And so many times I hear, like, when it's a grandparent maybe on their deathbed, or maybe it's a spouse or something, it's like, please, I don't want you to die and go to hell. Will you just please just accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And we hear reports, nah, they haven't done it yet. You know, and they go again, visit again. Please, please, I don't want to go to heaven and not you go. So that seems to be our message, is about trying to get to heaven. When God is actually trying to get his kingdom here on earth, he's trying to get it within you. And he's trying to get the reality of Christ in us and us in Christ now. For thy real kingdom is now. We are going to usher in the second coming of Christ. I believe that. But I've always believed that when I was a little girl. And I used to sit under preachers and thinking, any day now, any day. Why isn't that day appeared yet? Because the fullness of time has yet to come. But when that fullness of time comes, are we going to be ready? What is it like to be ready for thy kingdom to fully come, the king of the kingdom to fully come on earth? What do we have to do? Because the people in Noah's time didn't realize what was going to happen. And I guarantee you, the people, the majority of the people on the face of the earth right now do not know what's going to happen. We may not get a flood because God said he'd never do it that way again. But we are going to see the skies open up. We're going to see the Son of Man appear. And don't you know that people are going to have heart attacks? It says that they will lose their heart, the breath, everything. They're just going to... And are we prepared? Are we telling? Are we giving forth the good news? Hebrews 11:7, it was by faith that Noah built a large boat to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God, who warned him about things that had never happened before. By his faith, Noah condemned the rest of the world, and he received the righteousness that comes by faith. Interesting. It was by faith. Put your name in there. It was by faith that Linda built an ark for everybody to join in. It was by faith that I get up and preach. It's by faith that you go to work and share the love of Jesus. It's by faith that you read your word. It's by faith that you pray. It's by faith. Are you building your ark of faith and of freedom, of liberty, for others to join in on your life? Or are you just keeping it to yourself and your little boat looks like this? Just enough for me, God. Thank you very much. I'm safe. I'm going to heaven. Thank God. Praise you, Jesus. I'm going to go to heaven. Or are we going to actually go and like, man, I got to increase my life. I've got to increase my vessel. I've got to extend myself. I've got to increase the borders of my life so that more can come in, that more I have to give to others, more I have to offer them, more of God I have to offer them. I've got to increase my boat so that others are welcomed into thy kingdom. Think about Noah. I'm sure when he started building the boat, he started pacing it out and thinking, whoa, that's one heck of a big boat. What about your life? Are you increasing your life in God? And you can say, whoa, God, look what you're doing in my life. This is amazing. This is awesome. Acts 2:40 says, Peter, this is at the time of Pentecost, and Peter had been preaching, and it says that Peter continued preaching for a long time, strongly urging all of his listeners, save yourself from the crooked, from this crooked generation. Now, I love the Message Bible. Here it says, he went on in this vein for a long time. In other words, he just kept hammering it home and hammering it home. He didn't stop. He just kept hammering it home. He preached long in this vein for a long time, urging them over and over, get out while you can. Get out of this sick and stupid culture. That's the Message Bible. Have you ever thought about the culture in which we live, is sticking sick and stupid? Some of the things that are happening in our world, in our parliament, in our life, is sick and stupid. I can honestly say that, but we don't really use words like that in our home too often because we have grandchildren, so I have to be very careful. And you don't want to call anybody an idiot, because in the Word of God it says not to. So you have to be obedient to the Word of God. So don't use the word idiot, because everybody has value. Even if they cut you off in traffic, they're not an idiot. They're a person that has value. And what's that? Yeah, you can say it to the car, David said. It's usually not the car that's driving itself, though. So, but we got to think about it. We got to think about how do we live in a world. This is how I think, okay? You want to know how Linda Dishman thinks? This is how I think. I'm extremely practical. And I'm thinking, okay, God, you've called us out and into. You've called us out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. You've called us out from our sinful nature into a nature of righteousness. But you did not remove us from this world in which we live. You know, if it was about going to heaven, honestly, you and I, as soon as we got saved, we'd zapped up into heaven. If it was all about living in the high by sweet pie, high in the sky, whatever, cake, but you know, all that sort of stuff. I had an Adelphism coming and it didn't work for me. But anyway, it's like the pie in the sky, you know. It's like so many times we're just like, I just want to get to heaven. There's no problems up in heaven. No, but as soon as you get there, there would be, unless you're sanctified. God wants what happens. happens here on earth to make a difference in our life now. But it isn't just about our life, it's about the extension to others. And so as we move on, it's activating the real kingdom. So our complete salvation is what Jesus has done, it's who Jesus is, and it's what is our response to him. He has paid it all, so we have to seize this opportunity and say, okay, God, all my debt is forgiven. So why am I living in poverty? Why am I living in a poverty spirit where I don't think I'm worth anything? If Jesus has truly paid it all your debt is canceled, everything you had done in your life, all your sin, all your unbelief, everything when you come to Jesus Christ, all of that has been canceled and paid for in full. So if it's paid for in full, why do you and I still live like it's not? We should live differently. We are to live free. We are to live in prosperity of soul, it says. I want your soul to prosper. So therefore, how does our soul prosper? Our soul prospers because we actually receive the full, complete salvation. It's not by works, but it's only done by the principle of Jesus dying on the cross for you and I. It's not by what we can do to earn our salvation. It's acknowledging that he paid it all. It's completely fulfilled. Save yourself with a salvation that is provided by Jesus Christ that covers every act of life, now, what happened, now, and what will happen. I love the analogy as I was saved when I was four. I'm being saved now, and I will be saved on the day. I love that. So no matter if a storm comes in my life, I'm secure in my salvation. Are you? No matter what difficulties come my way, I'm secure. Are you? Acknowledging that we have this real kingdom activated in our life, we should live differently. So when obstacles come our way, temptations come our way, what are we going to do about it? Are we going to think that God's finished work isn't complete? Are we going to lose our temper because somebody says something negative towards us? Are we going to live in fear because things that had happened in our past? Maybe you were abused as a child or something like that. When are you going to get free from that? Because the work of Jesus set you free. But if you live impoverished in your soul, you're not actually living in the completeness of your salvation. And so we have to learn to walk this thing out so that we can enlarge our ark. Enlarge the place that God has in our life. Salvation that is complete is its provision. It's body, soul, spirit, and mind. It's complete provision in every way. So when we have negative thoughts, we have to go back to my salvation is complete. God changed my thought process. God redeem my mind, renew my mind, cancel out these wicked thoughts I have. When temptation occurs in your life, you flee from temptation, it says. You don't tempt yourself with temptation, you flee from temptation. That's how you live and activate the real kingdom of God in your life. You apply the word of God. Salvation is a progressive, it's ongoing, it's constantly working in our life. So if you constantly think, Jesus, you're saving me right now. Right now, you're saving me. So in my worship time, I'm saying, God, I'm soaking in you. I'm being saved. I'm being encouraged. I'm being built up. God, you are saving me right now because I'm going to walk tomorrow in this world. Am I prepared? Are you prepared as we walk in this world? That's why Sundays is so important. That is why when coming together and worshiping God or going to your community life group or praying one with another or having times alone with God are so important because that's what prepares you for the next stage. That's what gives you that freedom and that total complete salvation. It's ongoing. It's a complete work of Christ. And he never stops his work. And when you stuff up, apologize. You know, when you make a mistake, admit you've made a mistake. You know, when you think, oh, well, you know, it's, you know, just my nature. I'm just like this. Don't stand around me very long. I'll bop you one. We're supposed to die to our nature. Poor David. I mean, I've really been rough on him over the years. I'm probably rougher on him than he is on me. But David, what's that? But if you mind if I use an illustration? Of course not. this is how we practice death on one another. You say, oh my God, what is she going to say? But David's background, he came from an abusive background. I won't go into his story because it is his story. But some of the things and effects of his childhood, he grew up very frustrated in his life. His reaction of frustration has been something that's been difficult for him to conquer. He just gets frustrated. If he can't do something, he gets frustrated. Because there was a frustration in his life of he was never taught how to do things. And so if he didn't do it right, then he'd get hit. And so there was that unknown situation where it's like, am I doing this right? And then waiting to be hit, you know. And so he still, to this day, even though God has done a huge work in him, occasionally that thing rises up. He gets, and see, for me, as his wife, I'm seeing a perfect, completed man of God. And so when he disses himself, or he's negative about himself, as he once was even more so when we were first married, I hated that. I just, because it's not who he is. So the negativity in his life that he would come up and be angry or frustrated at himself was not giving glory to God who had done this finished work in him. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? We have a lot of work to do, you and I, for the coming of Jesus Christ the second time. You and I need a lot of work. We got to work on ourselves. We got to not say, oh, well, that's just how I am. Hey, man, I'm 80 years old. I'm not going to change now. No, we are to change every single day. We are to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. And we need to take a hold of those things in our life that hold us beneath that completed work of Jesus Christ, that take us outside of the circle. When there's a circle of completion, if you have anger, if you have disappointment, if you have grief, deal with these things, because these things are needing to be worked on in our lives, because it's what Jesus died for. He died for completed work. He died for freedom. He died that you and I would be different. So let's do this together. And that's why it's so important. Nobody is perfect. Everybody has fallen short of the glory of God. You know, so yeah, like I said, I think I was harder on David all these years. But he's been hard on me too. But I had less to work on. Oh, come on. Don't you believe that? Come on. Come on. I always said I was Mary Poppins, practically perfect in every way. I'm really kidding. I really am. Please don't take that seriously. 1 Thessalonians 5, 23, 24. Now may the God of peace make you holy in every way, and may your whole spirit and the soul and body be kept blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ comes again. God will make this happen, for he who calls you is fruitful, faithful, and you will be fruitful because of his faithfulness. There is a job you and I have to do. This thinking that, well, I'm saved and that's it. Jesus did it all. There's nothing I have to do. That's a load of rubbish, and that's going to keep you bound and not free. That's going to cause you to live a less than victorious life in Christ. If you just say, oh, there's nothing I can do. Jesus did it all, and I'm just going to go, woo-hoo, praise you, Jesus. No, we've got to work in our life to get it cleaned up. Allow the Holy Spirit to sanctify us. Just let him do it. Say, God, here's my gach. I'm going to barf it then heal me, set me free, deliver me. I don't want to have these attitudes. I don't want to have the stinking thinking. I don't want to be like this, God. I really don't. God, work in my life. I want to be a pleasing, wonderful vessel of honor and a beautiful fragrance of grace for you, God. I want people to actually go, wow, look at the work of God in you. Whether knowing my past or not is not the issue. People don't have to know your past and look at a finished work of Christ in you or an ongoing work of Christ in you. Most of you have no idea what your pastor David has been through in his life. You don't need to actually know that to actually see God in his life, do you? No. You see a holy man that's righteous in his actions and his heart for God. He's a man after the heart of God. You don't need to know what pit he was dug from. But when you do marvel even more. I have to admit that. But actually, you take and say, this is the gift of God. Each one of us here in this room are gifts of Christ to one another. And as we work on ourselves, we become a greater gift. We become a greater vessel. Why? Because it's easier for people to like us and get around us and know us. But when we're prickly and stiff and hard to get to know, it's hard. Come on, church. Put a smile on your face. You know, live a little, laugh a little, maybe do it a lot. I love Karen's laugh. It's an infectious laugh. Come on, Jude. Verse 24 and 25. Now all glory to God who is able to keep you from falling away and will bring you with great joy into his glorious presence without a single fault. The only God can do that. But he needs you to be pliable. He needs you to say, okay, here I am, God, just do it. Just don't hurt me too much. Just do it. I want to change. God, I want to bring glory to your name. God, I want to exalt you in my life. God, I want people to look at me. They look at me and they see you, Jesus. Not for works for ourselves, but for righteousness for God. So that when he actually sees us, he sees himself. But what does the world see when the world sees us? We're standing in the ark here. Neat thing about this is that said in when Noah gathered all the animals two by two, they all came to him and they all came into the ark. So visualize this is the ark. We're on the inside. Said after they had all gotten in there, Noah's family said that God shut the door. That door you can't open because it's actually shut from the outside. It's shut. God shut the door of the ark. And there's a principle that you and I need to get and understand is that when Jesus Christ fully enters into our life, God seals that work. He shuts the door. He doesn't want you to escape. There was a reason that God shut the ark. And Noah and all the animals inside that ark, there was a reason. And that one of the main reasons is so that when the boat was woo, and all the storm came and the floodwaters rose and everything, there was no way out. There was no way of escape. So many times in our life, we will look for a way of escape. Oh, this Christian life is just way too hard. You know, it's just not fair. I thought when I came to Jesus, all my problems would go away, and now they've magnified themselves 100-fold. It's just not fun. I want to get out of here. Oh, man, I don't like going to church. It's just too difficult. I have to sit for an hour and a half, hour and 45 minutes of Linda's teaching. It's just way too long. You know, I just, oh, man, I want to watch what's on TV on Sunday. I don't even know. But anyway, you know what I'm saying? It's like we look for ways of an escape. In the ark of God, there's safety. In God, in Jesus Christ, the ark is Jesus. As we come into him, there's safety inside of him. There's safety in who he is. He's the great I am. Yeah. Why do we try to figure it out ourselves? Just accept his love. Just accept his grace. Just accept his mercy. Just accept that you're not going to have all your questions answered. I get really upset when people go, well, when I get to heaven, I'm just going to ask God about this, this, and this, and this. And I'm just going to, oh, really? Like it's going to matter? I mean, really? You think you're even going to remember what your questions are when you see the holiness of God? Are you kidding me? Oh, Jesus, I've got something. I've got a bone to pick with you. Come on. Have we ever really experienced the great Holy One? When we come into his presence, it's really not going to matter what little question we had here on earth. Why did that so-and-so say that to me? Or why weren't you there when I was abused? Or what, blah, blah, blah. It's not going to make any difference. So forget about those things. Forget about those questions and seek God Almighty. Amen. Love him with your full heart. If you've been holding back part of your heart, going like, I don't really know what's going to happen if I give him everything. Give him everything. I guarantee you, it's better than having half of him. And him having half of you, give him everything. It'll work a lot better. So our ark is Christ. Couple things. I thought these 3 points that David brought along this morning were excellent, so we're going to go through them again. We need to have confidence in Christ and Christ alone. Confidence in the finished work of Christ, confidence in who he is, that he is our Lord and our Savior. Confidence in the Trinity of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Confidence in the Holy Spirit that he is continually doing a work in us. We're filled by the Holy Spirit. He's activated in our life. He's transforming our life. Just yield your life over to him. Yield your attitude over to him. Yield your rebellion over to him. Yield over to God. It's not that hard, all right? It really isn't. 51 years of following Christ, it really isn't hard. If it is hard, you're making it harder than it should be. You just have to put up your hand and say, here I am, Jesus. Here I am. Thank you, God. I love you. It's really, I am so basic. Really, it's not that hard following Jesus. Just keep saying yes to him. Keep yielding your heart to him. Keep surrendering to him. And it's just like, yep, sweet. And it becomes so easy after a period of time. So your confidence is like, there is no one else that I have any confidence in. I have none in myself. Certain things I do, and I have a degree of confidence, but my full confidence comes in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Not only in my life, but in your life. I don't live for a half work done. It's like, I love baking cookies, and I love them raw. Anybody else like me like the dough? Oh, yum. You know, it's just like, ooh, it's really good. But man, when they come hot out of the oven and that chocolate chip is just oozing out, you know, it's just yummy. You bite into it and it's like, you can just, it's wonderful. It's fully baked and there's just something about it that when it's complete. And there's something about your life that just oozes out the very beautiful nature of God and the taste and the fragrance of God is when you're fully baked, when you're actually going like, yes, I want all of you, God. I'm not holding anything back. I'm going to receive all of you. I love that. And guess what? He just goes, wow, look at you. Look at you. You're awesome. Confidence. There's no one else. It's completely in him. It's in the hands of Jesus himself. Hebrews 10, 35 and 39. Do not throw away this confident trust in the Lord. Remember the great reward it brings you. Patient endurance is what you need now. How many know that? So that you will continue to do God's will. Then you will receive all that he has promised. For in just a little while, the coming one will come and not delay. And my righteous ones will live by faith, but I will take no pleasure in anyone who turns away. Isn't it amazing how we have to remember the timeline of God? God's ways are not our ways. God's timing is not our timing. Okay? Since this period of time, it's 2,000 years. Don't you love it? It said that for in just a little while, the coming one will come and not delay. Well, it's been 2,000 years. It's just a little longer to go. But we are in those last days, of the last days. Jesus Christ, when he came, he ushered in and it was declared, this is the last days. So we are in the last days of the last days. But yet, our days are not yet fulfilled, and Jesus Christ is not yet coming. But are we going to be ready for when he does come? It's about being ready. It's not about when. I was thinking about this when I was sitting down and getting prepared for this, and I'm just going like, God, I know. I've studied all the, is it pre-trib, post-trib, mid-trib, studied all of the theological wordings and who says what and how it should be, and then you look at that argument and this argument, and you can find truth there, and you can find truth there, and you can find truth there, and you can find truth back here. And it's just kind of like we so many times are looking for how's it going to all work, when is all, that we're not preparing ourselves. We have a generation out there right now that's, when's he coming, when's he coming, when's he coming, when's he coming, that we're actually not preparing ourselves or others for his coming. The more you look and think, oh, when's he going to come, we lose sight of the here and now, and we don't use our time wisely for ourselves to be ready or for others to be ready. And so years come and years go. Are we going to be that generation that ushers in the second coming of Christ, when the clouds, the heavens split, and Jesus comes and returns? We have to be ready, because he's not going to come until his bride is prepared. He's not going to come until there's a generation that says, you and you alone, God. He's not going to come until everyone has heard the message. He's not going to come until we're ready. But the more that generations get lost, he holds back the return, the more responsibility is on us of why we didn't preach the message of his return. Second thing is clothing. We need spiritual clothing for this journey. We need to put off the old man and put on the new. Colossians 3:1-4, since you have been raised in this new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. Now you said, Linda, you just contradicted yourself. No, I didn't. I'm not looking for a heaven, a place to sit on a cloud and have a harp. I don't think I'd be very good at playing a harp. The reality is that our sights aren't about a place called heaven. Our sights is about a relationship with God. We must keep our relationship. Our sight of heaven is all about our relationship with God. We've got to keep that. We've got to keep our eyes fixed and focused on Jesus Christ, the author, the finisher of our faith. So it's like here it's saying, yes, set your sights above. God is working on our behalf. He is the one that's constantly coming in. He's going to rule and reign in our hearts and our lives. He's going to bring that peace that comes from Christ and Christ alone. Let the message about Christ and all of its richness fill our lives. Teach and counsel us over each other with the wisdom he gives. Sing songs, psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative, I'll get that out, of the Lord Jesus, giving him thanks through God our Father. Many times we lose sight of the thankfulness that you and I, like David came up and he said, you know, are we thankful for what God has done? Are we thankful for what he's doing in our life? Are we just thankful? And I often say to people, and I've said it a dozen times here, if not more, is that being saved at 4, you know, is like, woohoo, yay. I didn't have a whole lot of issues. I didn't have a whole lot of problems. I loved my parents. I wasn't rebellious. I did everything I was supposed to do at 4. I didn't have a real bad, sinful nature. You know what I'm saying? You know, I hadn't turned away. I hadn't run away from home yet. I hadn't drunk. I hadn't, you know, been drunk. I hadn't smoked or cussed or anything like that. like that. You understand what I'm saying? So when you look at the don't do list, I hadn't done any of those things. But in my journey of sanctification and knowing God, I am so thankful for what he saved me from. My life didn't go down into a pit. And when I was 16 and I was saying, God, I don't have much of a testimony, you know, I don't have much of a testimony. I haven't even cussed much. And, you know, just the under the breath stuff, you know. But, you know, honestly, my dad, this is the honest truth. I was probably 16 before I heard my dad even say a bad word. So it wasn't like in my home. I didn't live in a perverse home life. So I was so blessed, and I am so blessed. But I had to come to that, like David said tonight, that mercy. God, look what you saved me from. You saved me from a corrupt and a perverse world. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, that I haven't had to work as hard as other people. Thank you, God. I am so thankful. I am so thankful that I haven't had the journey that my husband David has had. Boy, am I thankful. I haven't had that real deep pain of grief and suffering and shame. I praise God. So if that is your journey, keep others from falling. I'll say to any teenager, don't you dare rebel. You'll regret it. You will so regret it. Anybody that has fallen when they're a teenager and rebelled when they're a teenager and now they've come back, they will say to that teenager, don't do it. It's not worth it. God shut the door. I never got out of the ark. That's what I'm saying. He shut that door and I remained in him. Hello? And the freedom that comes when you remain in Christ. Now, if we make mistakes, get back in. Yeah. If you jump ship, say, help, give me a lifeline. Jesus, come back. Hello, out there, can anybody hear me? Send me a lifeline. And grab a hold and get back in. And allow God to shut that door again. And like David said today, which is really good, don't just stand by the shut door. Hang on, I'm just going to stand right here. Thank you very much, God, for shutting me in. No, get all the way in. Amen. Come into the center. Get as far as you can in God. Amen. Don't hang around the outskirts of God. Don't hang around the outskirts of a local church, Change Point, or any other church. Don't play around and don't mess around. Get into the center. Get into your heart where you can say, God, you have all of my heart. Get in, because there is safety in the inside. You're going to regret living on the outside. You're going to regret living on the edges. That's where shame, that's where guilt, that's where condemnation, self-condemnation comes from. It's our mistakes because we've lived on the outside or on the sides. Get in, get all the way in. The third thing is just community. Do it with others. Do life with others. I have found that doing life with others is really painful. I have found that doing life with others is like, ooh, it's really hard. But I also found that the joys and the freedom and the understanding of the grace of God doing it with others. I remember years ago, we used to have this gal in our church that journeyed with for a very long time. And her background was far different from mine. And I journeyed with her for probably 10 or 12 years. And in the process, I remember saying to her, I said, look, I have learned more about the grace of God from you than I ever did from my own life. Because I journeyed with her, I saw the God's abundant grace poured out again and again and again and again and again and again, when really I didn't think she deserved it. I didn't think she deserved it. I was going, oh, God, you know, you're going to have to forgive Ananias and Sapphira. You know, you're going to have to forgive that so-and-so person. I mean, that he already has. But, you know, you're going to have to, man, this person is like lies and cheats and does all this thing, tempts you, God, puts you on the edge, God, all the time. And I thought, but, you know, I because I've done life with her, I've learned so much more about the grace of God. I've learned so much more about the unconditional love of God. I've learned so much more through others. You understand what I'm saying? We need others not only to help us in this journey, to hold us in this journey, but also to go, God, look at this, a trophy of grace. David and I stand up here on a Sunday, and I know Pastor Jeff's the same way, and anybody else that's been in the church life, we see trophies of grace. Oh, God, look what you've done. You've saved them. You've delivered them. You brought life into their life that was, their life was dead and going nowhere, and you brought life. God, look what you've done. We're all trophies of grace. You know, when we come to church, we think we're a bit messy, you know, but Jesus sits up there in heaven, and he goes, puts us, he sees where we're sitting down, and goes, oh, look at that trophy. Look at that one. Look at that. Ooh, that one's a big one. Look at that one. Look at that. Oh, my goodness. Look at that one shining now, you know. So God looks down at his people and says, look at the grace. Look at my trophies of grace. Look at yourself as Jesus sees you. Look at yourself in the completed work of Christ. Look at yourself totally redeemed and sanctified in him. Look at yourself and say, oh, God, I am not worthy, but thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Activating real kingdom, living a life that is worthy of the King, living a life that will bring honor and glory to his name. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, God, for the privilege once again. Wow. God, to just say, here I am, God. Here I am. God, work in me, work in my heart, work in my life, so that I might bring glory to you. God, I pray that within each one of us, Lord, you'll activate your kingdom in us, your real kingdom, because God, that's our real life. God, this is real life. It's not what we see on television. It's not, Lord, how people act in our communities or in their neighborhoods. God, this is what real life is supposed to look like, being fully loved and embraced by our God and our King, our Lord and our Savior. God, we honor you here. We honor you with our life. And God, as we start this new series, God, I pray that you will speak to us about, God, how to activate your kingdom, your real kingdom in us. God, how to get in and believe you for who you are. God, how to let go of our selfishness and let go of, Lord, our hurts and let go of petty things and attitudes. Let go. And God, when we stuff up, Lord, help us to forgive quickly, because Lord, we're expecting others to forgive us. So help us forgive others when they do stuff against us. God, thank you for your complete work. Thank you for the completed work of salvation in us. God, I pray, Lord, that we will see it as an ongoing journey, that Lord, you've begun a good work and you're continuing it, and you will continue it, and you will perfect it until the day of Jesus Christ. Lord, we are made in your image, and Lord, you're doing something marvelous in us. And God, when we look at ourselves and we don't see you, Jesus, forgive us. Lord, I pray that you'll forgive us. God, when our self-talk is so negative and frustrated or angry at ourselves, God, forgive us already. Because, Lord, you died to set us free. You died that we'd have life and liberty and wholeness. God, you died and you crucified on that cross so that, Lord, we would be different. We would be free. We would be set free. So, God, I forgive us. Forgive us, God, when we speak negatively about ourselves or others. God, forgive us so that we might fully embrace the wondrous work of you. We give you praise, God. Amen. 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 Thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight. Make sure you sign up for the prayer room, CPR room. It's awesome. There's great things that are going on, and people are being set free. People are being healed. People are being delivered in all kinds of different ways. Just the heart and hunger for God is emerging, so keep it up. You youth, you guys are amazing. I heard some were here till 5 o'clock this morning, so well done. Well done, night watch. Awesome, awesome. So be well.